So good morning and welcome to our assembly here today. Welcome to the very first iLEAD leadership event. Through some of the Schoology posts, or maybe if you're following us on Facebook or Twitter or Instagram, you may have seen a little bit of information about our iLEAD program. Our iLEAD program, as you can see by the banners that are standing up for up here, stands for Inspiring Leadership, Education, and Development. And this is a program that's new to Howard this year. It's exclusively for you all. It's exclusively for the students of Howard High School and not for any other students in any other school in the area. This is just for us. And it's designed to complement some of the existing leadership programs that we already have here at our school, such as the Howard Leading Ladies Club, the Gentlemen of Howard High School, the Cubs program, and some of our others. So it's a really exciting initiative that we are kicking off here today with our very first guest speaker. As we move forward throughout the rest of the school year, we will have some other guest speakers, and we'll also have some smaller workshops where it won't be as many students as we have here this morning working on particular leadership topics. I would like to take this opportunity, since this is the first time that we've been gathered as nearly a whole school since the end of the first marking period, to recognize some students who have done some outstanding things so far this school year. This is not all of our students and all of our accomplishments, but just a few of those things. So during the first marking period, we had 80 students who earned honor roll. In addition to that, we had 180 who earned distinguished honor roll. And we had 211 students who earned triple crown for the first marking period. So we have students who are doing absolutely fantastic things, and we wanted to say thank you, congratulations, and keep up the good work. Today, I'm really pleased to present a very special leader who will be speaking with you for our very first iLEAD event. He is the Reverend Dr. Donald Morton. Some of you are already familiar, some of you may know Dr. Morton, some of you may be familiar with him through some of the posts that have been communicated with some of the information about his background. What you may not know, however, is that like many of you, he is part of the legacy of Howard High School. Not only was he a graduate of Howard High School, but his mother and great-grandmother were graduates of this school as well. And many of his children have attended Howard High School. He is a part of our legacy. It is my pleasure right now to introduce Dr. Donald Morton as our guest speaker. Please join me in welcoming him.
Can y'all give me a better round of applause than that? How many of y'all happy to be Wildcats in the room? Come on, Wildcats, make some noise. Howard Thurman is a theologian, was a theologian. He was also a philosopher. Howard Thurman was a civil rights leader. Here's what he said. Howard Thurman said that there are two questions that every person must ask. They must ask, number one, where they're going. And then number two, he said, they must ask, who are they taking with them? Here today, we're going to answer both questions. Number one, we're going to answer where we're going. And number two, we're going to answer who's going with us. Because how many know we can't take no haters with us? Look at your neighbor, say, if you a hater, move your seat. Tell him, if you a hater, move. I felt like it was necessary, not just to answer that question. Number one, who are we? Number one, where are we going? Number two, who are we taking with us? But number three, I felt like we needed to answer the question, who are we? My name is Donald Morton, Reverend Dr. Donald Morton. Some of you may know me. I'm a 1987. I know, that's old, sis. Don't do that. 1987. Give me high.
I'm 99.
Give me high five, girl. 1987 graduate of Howard, what was then Howard Career Center. It is now Howard High School of Technology. My mother graduated here in 1956. My mother, Mr. Williams, graduated here. My great-grandmother graduated here, then went to Delaware State University, and then was also Delaware State College then, and then was also a principal at one of the high schools. Here's what I will tell you, though. That success between the time you graduate high school, in high school, or wherever you decide to go after this, success comes with some obstacles. It comes with some impediments. It comes with some challenges. You don't get where you're going without somebody trying to stop you. It just doesn't happen. You don't get where you're going. You don't get success, the kind of success that I know every one of you want. You don't get success without having something in your way to be able to overcome. It's amazing to me that everybody wants to overcome without something to overcome. Everybody wants to be an overcomer. Everybody wants to do great things, but everybody wants to do it without a sense of challenges that come with being who you are. 1984, I got here to Howard. It does seem like a long time ago, but I still look good. Don't play me, I still look good, right? So here's what I found out, though. 2 years before getting to Howard, everybody shout obstacles.
Obstacles.
That's only some of y'all. I said everybody shout obstacles.
Obstacles.
Watch what happens. 2 years before me getting here in 1984, I'm the product of Edward Donald Morton Sr., who is my father, and Bishop Aretha Morton, who is my mother. My mother and my father, they break up. So did yours. No, I'm not putting her out there. She said it. So what happens is I'm now the product of what is less than the nuclear family. I've got challenges. I've got a life with my mother, and I've got my father, watch this, who moves away to Los Angeles, California. We're in Delaware. He moves all the way to Los Angeles, California. Here's my question. What would make a man who I idolize move as far away from me as he possibly could to get to Los Angeles, California while I'm here? What did I do? Was it something that I did wrong that made him run? It couldn't have been seemingly the challenges that my parents had. And at that age, I'm thinking there's something that I did that was wrong, sis. Here's what I found out. There's nothing that went wrong. My mother and my father, later on, Mr. Williams, my mother and my father decided that they were going to reconcile. It was the greatest thing in the world for me. My dad's my hero. So he was going to move back from California to Delaware. My parents would be back together. And I would finally have what I thought I should have in the beginning. I would finally have my mom and my dad in the same space along with my sister. It was a good day. Mr. Williams, I came home from school. My mom said to me, she said, she called me buddy at that time. Y'all can't call me buddy. She called me buddy. At that time, she said, baby, I need to sit you down. I need to talk to you. I need to tell you something. I was due to go to the movies that day. That's all that was popping at that time. You know what I'm saying? I was due to go to the movies that day. And my mom said, sit down. I need to talk to you. And I said, what's going on? We're not going to the movies? She said, no, it's a little more serious than that. So what is it? Your father died. Now, I need you to understand my mindset because I'm talking about obstacles. Everybody shout obstacles.
Obstacles.
Talking about obstacles. My father dies a couple of weeks before he's supposed to come home. We funeralize him. He's laying in the casket in the front of the church that I now pastor. He's in front. I'm sitting on the front pew. And I'm looking, everybody's crying, I'm angry. I know y'all don't know what it is to be angry. I know that everything in your life is lollipops and candy canes, but can I tell you that sometimes you're gonna have to learn how to overcome adversity. Because everyone, sir, everyone that has ever done anything significant has had to overcome something significantly against them. Everyone. We funeralized my father. Now I'm challenged because my hero is gone. I still got my mom. She's beautiful. She's wonderful. But there are some things she can't teach me. Some things I just wouldn't get. But here's what I learned. I learned that even though my father passed, even though I was emotionally a wreck, even though I had challenges and things going on in my mind, and I had to answer questions alone and by myself, I had to do a lot of things that I should have had been able to do with my daddy in the room. I'm mad at him. And for years after that, I was still mad at him. He left me. Wasn't my mom's fault, it was my fault. Something I did, sir, that would cause him to leave. But today, I stand in front of you as a 2015 graduate of Howard University's Executive Ministers for Leadership program, a program that is in their School of Business. I'm a fellow of Princeton Seminary's Black Leadership, Black Theology and Leadership Institute. I'm a graduate of Howard High School. I pastor one of the largest churches in the state of Delaware. Look at your neighbor and say, he got it going on. He got it going on. And let me tell you what happened, though. What caused me to have it going on is the fact that I focused, I had enough discipline, and I would not stop even in the face of adversity. I kept going even when the challenges presented themselves in my life. I want to tell you something else that Howard Thurman says. Howard Thurman says, keep alive the dream in one's heart, because as long as one has a dream, he or she can't lose the significance of living. As long as you have a dream, you cannot lose the significance of living. As long as you've got a dream, as long as you've got something on the inside that drives you to wake up tomorrow, you can never lose the significance of living. As long as you got a dream. As long as you got a what?
A dream.
A what?
A dream.
As long as you got a dream, you can never lose the significance of living. I found out that I was one that had enough discipline and focus to move forward. But here's what else I found out, sis. I found out that I'm a resilient man. Can I tell you this? That one of the most amazing things about you is you, whether you realize it or not, you are a resilient group of people. You had to overcome challenges. You had to overcome lifetime heartaches and pains and things in school and things out of school and things at home. You had to address those kinds of things. And so you're a resilient people. Lean on your neighbor. Say, I'm resilient, baby. Yes, I am. I'm resilient. And a part of what makes me resilient is I keep getting up. Listen to me. I keep getting up even when I don't feel like it. Let me ask you a question. How many are here today and you ain't even feel like coming to school? You play too much there. But let me tell you how wonderful it is, bro. Let me tell you how wonderful it is. Everyone that raised their hand didn't feel like coming to school, but guess where you are?
School.
You're in school. You know why? Because you're resilient. You got focus. You got a goal. You got to get something done, and you won't let the feelings that you have get in the way of accomplishing your goal. I found out I'm willing to sacrifice, sir. I found out I'm willing to be disciplined. I found out I'm willing to be focused. I found out that I'm resilient. But here's what else I found out. This is what's going to be a trip. Don't miss this. I found out that I'm nothing without helping somebody else. I'm a Baptist preacher, so I just wait for somebody to say amen.
Amen.
I found out, you better stop playing, girl. I found out that me having success without helping my neighbor have success means I'm not successful at all. That if in fact I've made it and I'm not helping someone else to make it, how good is my success? What is it all for? A couple years ago, I went to Ghana in Africa, in West Africa. And when I went to Ghana, here's what I found out. I found out that they all in the marketplace sell a certain product. In Ghana, everybody sells the same thing. Everybody sells shoes, artwork. Everybody sells the same thing. And I went to go buy, Dr. Spoor, a piece of artwork. And the lady ran out. But here's what she said, sis, don't miss this. She said, I don't have it, but the lady right next to me does. So it's amazing for me because in America, you go into a store and you tell them, I don't have it. They say, well, it doesn't exist anywhere in the country. They try to get you to purchase something else in their store to make you think that you don't even want what you want. She said this. She said, my neighbor's got it. I said, why would you talk to me about what your neighbor has? Your neighbor makes the same thing that you make. Here's what she said. She said, I'm successful when both of us are successful. Y'all missed a good place to shout. She said, I'm successful when both of us are successful. If both of us aren't successful, neither of us are successful. You have a responsibility to the person sitting next to you. You have a responsibility to pull up the individuals that are in your life. You got a responsibility to restore people that have fallen, that have been broken, because guess what? You ain't get to where you are by yourself. Look at your neighbor and say, by yourself.
By yourself.
I didn't say yourself. I didn't say yourself. I said, by yourself. You gotta pull up people to the place that you are in. Let me give you this last point. I'm a Baptist preacher. I got three closings. This is my last one. Let me tell you what else I found out. One of the things my pride wouldn't allow me to do is to explore my own weaknesses. Because everyone in the room thinks that you're not susceptible to a weakness. I will tell you that as a preacher, when I look in the Bible, I always see humans. I don't see miracles. I see humans because life is full of humans. Humankind with failures and frailties and challenges. And here's what I know. My success really began when I stopped pretending like I didn't have challenges. When I stopped pretending like I didn't have any frailties. When I was at Howard, don't laugh at me, man, I'm sensitive. When I was at Howard, let me tell you what, I was about this tall, and I was about 112 pounds. How'd you know? I was about 112 pounds. I played basketball until I injured my knee, right? I played ball until I injured my knee, but here's what I was able to do. I was the nerd dude. I was the dude that was caught in the books every single day. In fact, I was the dude that helped the popular dude be popular. because he couldn't even be on the team unless he had good grades, and he couldn't get good grades unless I was in the room tutoring him. Look at your neighbor and say, he's a bad man, he's a bad man. So here's what you got to know. Everybody's got a lane. And education is not corny. Being educated and being an intellectual is not corny. In fact, let me just tell you, you're fine, sister. Let me just tell you this. At the moment sisters begin to challenge brothers and change your criteria for who you date. I'm talking about leadership, y'all. When you start changing the criteria for who you date and not success based on a car or clothes or cash, when you ask that brother, what's your number? Or when he asks you, what's your number? You ought to be talking about a GPA and not a phone number. Ooh. There is nothing popular about a brother in a nice car with a lot of money that can't formulate a sentence. Let me give you this last thing. The dangers of success is forgetting from where you've come and to whom you're called. Your success doesn't just belong to you, it belongs to everyone that helped you. Your success doesn't just belong to you, it belongs to everyone that helped you. So that you develop a mindset that teaches others the powerful and awesome responsibility in lifting up another human being. That you've reached your higher self when you help someone reach their higher self. In this room, there are two kinds of people. There are thermometers and there are thermostats. A thermometer can read a room. It can take the temperature of a room, but a thermostat can change the environment. A part of what I'm asking Howard Wildcats to do is don't just read the room. Change the environment of the room. Because there's something in you, sir, that's great enough not just to change this school, not just to change this city, not just to change this state. There's a world-changing possibility on the inside of you if all of us would dare to unlock it. There's something inside of you. I got an Uncle Stephen. This ain't even in my notes, but I got to give it to you. I got an Uncle Stephen. Everybody laughed at him when he was younger because he got good grades. It's amazing to me how good grades is funny and bad grades is popular. Yeah, look at your neighbor and say, that's sad, for real, for real. I'm done here. I told you I'm a Baptist preacher. I'm done here. Here's what else Howard Thurman says. He said, don't ask what the world needs. He said, ask yourself what makes you come alive and do it. Because what the world needs is a people that have come alive. Howard Wildcats, I challenge you. Whatever that thing is on the inside of you, that thing, whatever that thing is on the inside of you, I dare you to unlock it. And I dare you to come alive so that you become not just thermometers, but thermostats that change this entire world. Thank you all for listening to me. I appreciate y'all so much.
Let's give Dr. Morton one final round of applause. At this time, we have several questions that have come from audience members. And we'd like to give those students an opportunity to ask Dr. Morton a couple of questions. Our first one.
Good morning, my name is Sianna Jones, and if you could choose only one quality that you think is most important for a teenager to become successful as an adult, what would it be?
Very good question. Her question is, if you could choose one quality that's important as a teenager to become successful, what would that quality be? It's in one single word. It's perseverance. You cannot give up. If you persevere, if you decide that nothing can stand in the way of the goal that you've set, no matter what it is. If you look at any successful person that is successful today, they will tell you that they have had to persevere through some very challenging times. And if you decide that perseverance is what you'll be known as or for, then I promise you, you'll reach your goal. It doesn't mean that your goal won't be sometimes come against in a way that it looks like it's not going to happen. But I promise you, if you keep going, everybody say keep going.
Keep going.
If you keep going, then you'll begin to see your dreams fulfilled and come true. So perseverance, sis, I believe is the number one quality everybody has to have.
Good morning, my name is Morgan, and my question is, were you scared of failing and not being good enough, and how did you cope with it?
Very good question. Was I afraid of failing and not being good enough, and how did I cope with it? Well, here's what's amazing. My mother allowed me to do whatever I wanted to do. So I have been everything on the planet. I'm a pastor now, I'm a theologian now. But prior to that, you know, I wanted to play basketball. I was pretty good at it, right? And so I thought I was Magic Johnson, even though I was 4'11", right? I have a black belt in karate in Goju, right? So I had all these things, and whatever I did, I always aspired to be the best at it, no matter what I did. I never wanted to be a preacher because my mother was a preacher. And I thought preachers were corny. I didn't want to do that. And I didn't want to put up with the headache of what, watch this, I didn't want to put up with the headache of helping people go through their storms. I didn't want that responsibility. And here I am today having overcome that, right? And my chief responsibility now is not to reach my potential, but to help you reach yours. And so, you know, I never was afraid of failing. I would try anything once. And if I wasn't good at it, I was wise enough to leave it alone and find what it is God had called me to do. That answer your question? Thank you, sis.
Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is Andre, and my question is, what are the qualities that we should look for in our friends?
Qualities that you should look for in your friends. Good question. So let me say this. Friends, if you don't hear anything else I said today, and I hope you hear everything I said, friends are born for times of adversity. The only way you know you have a friend is if they're there in a bad time. Anybody can be with you when everything's right. Most people want to hang with you when everything's right. But it's when everything goes bad, right, that life unveils who my real friends are. Now, check this out. If you couldn't be with me in my struggle, then you are dismissed from me when times are good. Ooh. So there are many people that disqualify themselves because they only want to hang around you when things are good. And you got to be with things, they got to be with you when things are bad. Is that it?
Good morning. My name is Christina. And my question for you is, did you have a favorite teacher at Howard, and how did he or she influence you? Did you have a favorite teacher at Howard, and how did he or she influence
you? Did I have a favorite teacher at Howard? I did. She is no longer with us. Her name was Mrs. Yvonne T. Jensen. Mrs. Yvonne G. Jensen was an English teacher. In fact, Miss Jensen is the one that taught me, along with my mother, how to say January. That it's not January, it's January. So whenever I'm in my mother's presence, if you look it up, you'll find it. It's January, right? And so Miss Jensen was an influential teacher. Miss Jensen was an influential teacher. There was a guy here by the name of Mr. Quam. Remember Mr. Yeah, what's up? Mr. Quam. And then y'all might know this guy. There was a teacher by the name of Mr. Kennedy. Mr. Kennedy was also an influential teacher. All of them deposited in me a sense that I could be and do whatever it is I wanted to do and to become. And so I want to thank you all so much for welcoming me and having me be a part of today.
So thank you, Dr. Morton, once again, for coming to speak with us and for sharing your words of wisdom. Dr. Morton, if you would please come forward. On behalf of the students and staff, we have a very small token of appreciation to present to you. And inside the gift bag are a number of items that connect to Howard High School. Oh, cool. And so we thank you so much for coming to speak to us today.
Sir. Thank you, man. Love you, man. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
There's chocolate in there, so don't let it melt.
Okay.
All right. As a follow-up to our speaker today, we encourage you to look to Schoology in the coming days. There may be some follow-up questions, comments that we'd like to ask you to respond to, so that the message that Dr. Morton delivered today sinks in. So walk away from this with something that you can incorporate into your life. What message did you hear today that really resonated with you? And what is it that you will take forth from Dr. Morton's message today? With that, I wish you all a very happy and safe holiday season. Please enjoy your time with family and friends.